Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I'm gonna kinda maybe backpedal just a little bit on a statement that I made in one of my most recent episodes about lambdas, when I said that it's not possible to put a lambda in a container. There is a way to do that. It's just ugly, but you should stay tuned for it. And of course, I am available. Code reviews, contracting, on-site training. You should contact me about those things, and you should check out the links in the video description to the puzzle books and C++ best practices books and upcoming events that I am going to be speaking at and putting on, and all of those things. I said that there are ways to put lambdas in containers, but it's a little bit ugly. That's mostly correct. There's actually three different ways that you might put lambdas in containers. And, let's just say I want to create a vector of lambdas. So I need to figure out what the type of this vector would be, and then I need to figure out how to actually put that in there. Now, a funny thing about lambdas in C++ is that we're not allowed to actually know the type of the lambda. Although we could do this. We can say, give me the decal type of that lambda and make a vector of it. So what is the type of the lambda? I want a vector of that thing. And then I could go and do a pushback of this lambda L. But what does that gain me? Why would I want to have multiple copies of the exact same lambda? Now, interestingly, just to be clear, this does work with some sort of capture as well. All right, so this works like this, but it doesn't really gain us anything. Or does it? Does it gain us something? Maybe it gains us something. We might be able to do something like a pre-increment of I and add that to j. And then if we've got a mutable lambda so that this compiles, and then let's say I want to call L. So that just incremented the I, and then I make a copy of it to add that here. That's plausible. And keep some sort of running count of the current copy of the lambda. I'm having a hard time actually coming up with a use case here. But that's weird and difficult to use. So let's go ahead and say this is the case that the average programmer is going to look at. We know that we want a function that returns an int and takes an int, and then we try to coerce this lambda to pass it into it. And this works and makes considerably more sense because I can actually push back that lambda and I can push back an entirely new lambda. Let's just make this an identity function or something. I don't know. Just have it return the exact same thing again. But if you watched those previous episodes on standard function and lambdas, then we know that this is like an awful lot of overhead, and we can just kind of do a hand-wavy scroll through and say, wow, oh no, look at all of the code that was generated. Isn't that terrible? In the case, and again, if you watched that previous episode, in the case that we don't have a capture, this thing is implicitly convertible to a function pointer. This one below here is also convertible implicitly to a function pointer. And we can declare our vector as a vector of function pointers that take ints and return ints. And that works, and it's going to be considerably less overhead because we don't have all this compile time and runtime type erasure overhead that we get from using standard function, but then we've just limited ourselves to not being able to have a lambda with a capture. Okay, so can we do something slightly more useful? Let's go ahead and go back to this decal type version. So that's the decal type of L. We're not allowed to know its type. We can't push back another lambda that takes an int and returns an int, even if we're explicit about it here, because they're different types. It's required to be different types. And we might even see this here. So this is main auto lambda 6, whatever. No known conversion from, this is going to be fun, from main lambda int to lambda auto 6. Okay, let's make this another, let's make this an int one. Okay. So yeah, no known conversion from main lambda int to basically main lambda int. That's incredibly helpful. Thank you, GCC. That is exactly the kind of feedback that I needed from you. So let's just see if Clang gives us slightly better error here. So, okay, this one tells us cannot convert from type, no known conversion from lambda source at line 11 to lambda source at line 6. Okay, that's at least something. We now know that these are two different types of lambdas, even though they don't really look different to us. And as we saw previously, we're able to do it with a function pointer with absolutely no problem whatsoever. Okay, how do we do the magic? There is a way to do this, in fact. What we can do is create a function that takes some values. Let's just take, I don't know, some value. And we're going to return a lambda that captures that value, takes an int, and always returns I plus that value. So this is a well-known lambda type. There's going to be exactly one type defined here. That is whatever the name of this thing is. I'm not allowed to name it, but it is this auto return type. So this is all valid C++ 14. So now if I were to come in here and I were to say create a vector of the decal type of the result of calling this make lambda function with some value. So I just need to pretend like I'm calling that function with some value and say, give me the type of that. That's what I want. I want the type of that. Now, if I call make lambda with the value 1, and I call it again with the value 2, then I can do this. And look at that, the compiler is actually able to optimize away the entire thing. Now that's Clang, and it's Clang's heap elision with standard vector coming into play. Let's go ahead and move it back to GCC just so we have a little bit more of a stable question here. It's approximately, I'm just again hand waving here, approximately the same amount of code that was generated when we had a vector of function pointers. That is at least mildly interesting. It's also pretty dangerous, actually. So if I wanted to create a function, let's call it make vector of lambdas. So this is just a little helper function for us. But this code has a problem because it relies on the type of a lambda that is defined inside this compilation unit. It would, shall we say, be subject to ODR problems. Each compilation unit is going to be getting its own type of vector that is based on its own lambda type. 99% sure that's correct. Pretty positive this is not a good idea, particularly to use in any sort of public header, but it's interesting. A probably smarter idea would be to simply create your own type . Now we can get the exact same behavior, but without any questions of ODR, relatively simply defined code, and reusability if we wanted it. And this becomes a little bit unnecessarily complicated down here as well. So just an aside that it's relatively easy to create your own callable if you actually wanted to do something like this, but it is in fact technically possible to create a vector of lambdas if you were so inclined, and that can be done with some decal type foo, with function pointers, with standard function, which now we have to question, is that actually a vector of lambdas? No, that's a vector of standard function wrapper object. So we're not gonna go there. Or by creating your own callable type that's just like the C++ lambda created for you. And I've done so many episodes on lambdas, including I think there's an episode on what is a lambda exactly. Not difficult to implement yourself in this particular scenario. So there you go. Hopefully this was a fun episode. It was, you know, an interesting exploration for me to play around with actually doing these decal types on lambda return types from functions, and then playing with what kind of code the compiler generated and what my options were. So hopefully it was some fun for you as well. So be sure to subscribe and check out my other episodes.